Welcome to the introductory lecture for Module 3 of the Principles of Clinical Pharmacology course. My name is Lisa Cordes, and I'm an Oncology Clinical Pharmacy Specialist at the National Institutes of Health, and today we'll focus our presentation on drug metabolism and drug transport. The primary objective of the lecture today is to go over the basic principles and provide you with an overview or even perhaps a review of the basic concepts of drug metabolism and drug transport. The faculty in the subsequent lectures of this module will then go into these topics into greater detail. So we'll start with drug metabolism, and we'll do an introduction and discuss the clinical relevance. We'll focus on phase 1 and phase 2 metabolism, and then give cytochrome P450 as our example. For drug transporters, again, we'll talk about an introduction and discuss clinical relevance. We'll talk about the ABC and SLC superfamilies, and go into P-glycoprotein for our example. And as you've learned from the previous lectures in this course, drug metabolism is one of the steps in the pharmacokinetic process. So what exactly is metabolism? Metabolism is the biotransformation, or how the body changes a substance into a new entity or chemical, which is known as a metabolite. And this is important because most drugs are administered in their lipophilic form. And the lipophilic characteristics are important to allow the molecule to pass through plasma membranes and reach their site of action. However, these same lipophilic characteristics actually hinder the elimination of the drug from the body. So we need metabolism in order to transfer the molecule into a more polar or hydrophilic compound in order to allow for elimination. And this primarily occurs in the hepatic enzymes, but it does also occur in the small intestine for orally administered products. So knowledge of drug metabolism is vital for both people who develop pharmaceuticals and for those caring for our patients. And we need to know how exactly a drug is broken down after we administer it. So here are a couple of examples. Most drugs are administered as an active compound. That is then metabolized or broken down into an inactive compound, which is then eliminated from the body. However, some drugs are administered as inactive compounds. Those are then transferred into active compounds, and this is known as a prodrug. We do occasionally have some compounds that are administered in the active or inactive form, and these are actually broken down into toxic metabolites. And it's important that we're aware of these so that we can quickly eliminate them so that they don't cause unexpected adverse events. So these compounds can be broken down through phase 1 metabolism or through phase 2 metabolism, but in most scenarios, they occur from phase 1 metabolism, and then that's followed by phase 2 metabolism. So we'll look at this table here, and we'll start with phase 1 metabolism. So as you can see here, we have phase 1 metabolism is known as functionalization. And this is where a functional group, such as OH or NH2, is either added to or unmasked from a parent drug, the drug that's administered. And this is primarily done through an oxidation reaction in the endoplasmic reticulum of the cell. As a result of this process, we typically just see a small change in the hydrophilicity. Subsequently, we see phase 2 metabolism, and this is known as conjugation. And this is when a covalent link is formed between that functional group that we just talked about in phase 1 metabolism and an endogenous substrate. And this is primarily done through glucuronide conjugation. And metabolites formed in these synthetic reactions are more polar, thus allowing for better elimination. In other words, we see a major increase in the hydrophilicity of these drugs through phase 2 metabolism. First pass metabolism is unique to orally administered products, and it's where the concentration of an oral product is greatly reduced before it ever reaches systemic circulation. And as you can see in this image, the small intestine and the hepatocytes of the liver are the primary site of an activation during first pass metabolism. And we'll go through this image step by step so you can get a good understanding of this process. So here we have the drug. In this case, it's a tablet that's administered in its oral form. As you can see here, it's going through the GI system into the stomach, where it reaches the small intestine. And this is the place where most oral medications are absorbed. So you can see here, we'll jump over into a more detailed view of the small intestine. So we have the drug here in the lumen, and that's going to get into the enterocyte of the small intestine, where it's going to run into something called CYP3A4 or cytochrome P450-3A4. And this is an enzyme that's involved with drug metabolism, and we'll go into it more on the next page. But this just represents any enzyme that can be involved in drug metabolism. So once the drug is in the enterocyte of the small intestine, the CYP3A4 enzyme actually breaks it down, and in this case, mostly into inactive components, 70%, and only 30% of the drug product is left in its active form. We'll then jump over to the main picture here, and it is going to then get into the liver. And here's a more detailed version of that process. So currently it's in the sinusoid, again in that 30% active form, where it's going to get into the hepatocyte of the liver. And once again, it's going to run into CYP3A4, where it's going to undergo further metabolism. And it's going to break down further into inactive metabolites, and then only 15% of the drug product in this case is still in its active form. That 15% of the active form will then go on for systemic circulation. And in this case, this product is known to have high first pass metabolism. And the extent of the first pass metabolism depends on a number of physiological factors. And these include enzyme activity, as we just described, and also GI motility. And you might come across this clinically when you have a drug that's administered orally and the dose is much higher of that oral form compared to when it's administered in the IV formulation. So as I just described, cytochrome P450 is involved with drug metabolism. So what exactly is the cytochrome P450 system? So this is a microsomal superfamily of enzymes that catalyzes the oxidation of drugs. And so we know, since we're seeing oxidation in this step, that it's involved with phase one metabolism, as we described earlier. I do want to take just a moment to describe the nomenclature of cytochrome P450. So cyto comes from the fact that it's bound to membranes within a cell. Chrome P means that it contains a heme pigment. And the 450 comes from the fact that it absorbs light at a wavelength of 450 nanometers when it's exposed to carbon monoxide. Here's an example with CYP3A4. So each enzyme encoded by a cytochrome P450 gene is named CYP, as you can see here. In this case, the group is number 3, the subgroup is A, and finally at the end we have the gene, in this case 4. Now it's thought that the cytochrome P450 is the most clinically important of the phase one metabolizing processes. And it's thought that humans have approximately 60 cytochrome P450 genes, accounting for about 3/4 of enzymes involved in drug metabolism. And we believe that the most clinically significant of these enzymes are cytochrome P450-3A4 and CYP2D6. So since discovering cytochrome P450 back in the 1950s, we've learned that many variables impact how a drug is metabolized, and one of these is genetic factors. So a specific gene encodes a specific enzyme that's involved in metabolism. So we'll go through an example here in this slide. So let's say we give a normal metabolizer a substance that is a cytochrome P450 2D6 substrate. We would anticipate the standard metabolism, the expected toxicities, and the anticipated efficacy. So really nothing out of the ordinary than what's published in the literature. However, if we give a patient who's thought to be a poor metabolizer that same drug at that same dose, we might actually see decreased metabolism, and that patient might have more toxicities than we would expect. On the other side of the spectrum, we have ultra rapid metabolizers. So these patients are thought to metabolize the drugs too quickly, and that could actually lead to decreased efficacy and possibly therapeutic failure of that substance. So drug-drug interactions also play a big role in drug metabolism. We have our CYP substrates that we just talked about, and we also have our CYP inhibitors and our CYP inducers. And this classification system helps aid in predicting the impact of a CYP inhibitor or inducer on the AUC, or area under the curve, of the substrate. So take, for example, a strong CYP inhibitor. Strong CYP inhibitors have shown to increase the AUC of their sensitive substrates by approximately 5-fold. Strong CYP inducers are thought to decrease the AUC of the sensitive index substrates by greater than or equal to 80%. And so typically, strong inducers and strong inhibitors are thought to be clinically significant. There are other coexisting conditions, such as chronic liver failure and advanced heart failure, that also play a role in drug metabolism. So as you can imagine, if we take a patient that's in front of us and think about all these different factors that play a role in drug metabolism, we might actually be able to modify that dose based on these patient-specific factors so that we can prevent a toxicity or we can prevent therapeutic failure. So let's transition gears a little bit into the basics of drug transport. So what exactly are membrane transporters? So these are proteins involved with the transport of their substrates across cell membranes. And this results in either the transfer of drug molecules into the cell, which is known as influx, or drug molecules out of the cell, which is known as efflux. And remember that biomembranes are predominantly lipophilic in nature. So lipophilic compounds can generally pass through that cell membrane through passive diffusion. However, transporters are actually needed for hydrophilic substances to cross those membranes. So why is this important clinically? In the early 2000s, it was actually brought to light that transporters were involved in drug-drug interactions. It's also important because it is thought to have an impact on drug efficacy. So this we can see with cancer cells and with bacteria cells. So cancer cells and bacteria are very smart. They actually overexpress efflux transporters. So if a drug gets into a bacteria or a cancer cell, for example, and the primary objective would be to cause apoptosis or kill that cell. However, that cell is smart and actually has these efflux transporters overexpressed, so there are a lot of them that actually efflux that drug product out of that cell and don't allow that treatment to do its job. So transporters are overexpressed or expressed on various types of cell membranes, but the ones on plasma membranes are really the ones we think about that are being important for pharmacology. And they're divided into two major subfamilies, and that is the ATP binding cassette, ABC as we see here, and the solute carrier, or SLC, as we see here. Now, ABC transporters are active transporters, and they require energy to move against the concentration gradient, and they're responsible for efflux. So that's demonstrated here with our ABC transporter, which is an efflux transporter. On the other hand, SLC transporters, for the most part, they're involved with the uptake of small molecules into the cell. This diagram as a whole shows the transepithelial and transendothelial flux of drugs, and we can see that primarily occurs in the small intestine, in the liver, in the kidney, and in the blood-brain barrier. We do also see see transporters in the testes and in the placenta. And interestingly, it's thought that efflux transporters were thought to be an evolutionary adaptation against potentially toxic substances, allowing them to protect vital organs. We'll go through one example of P-glycoprotein. P-glycoprotein is an ABC transporter, so it's involved with the efflux of substances out of the cell, and it's also known as ABCB1. And here's an example. So P-glycoprotein is expressed on the enterocytes in the small intestine, and typically it reduces the oral bioavailability of drugs that are its substrates. So here we have our PGP substrate that's in the cell, the enterocyte of the small intestine, and the PGP transporter is effluxing that substrate out of that cell, and then it's going to get sent for elimination. If, however, we give a PGP inhibitor concurrently with the PGP substrate, we see that the PGP inhibitor blocks that transporter efflux out of the cell. That results in an increase of the PGP substrate within the cell, and that means more of that PGP substrate is available to go on to systemic circulation. Opposite of that, we actually have PGP inducers, which cause more of that PGP substrate to be out of that cell, and that will decrease the PGP substrate in the cell, again, decreasing the concentration of the substrate that's available for systemic circulation. Wrap up this lecture. As you have seen, drug metabolism and transport are complex processes, and I hope I've been able to provide you with a basic introduction to these concepts. Please continue to watch the subsequent lectures in this module for a more in-depth look. Thanks for watching.